Hi! This tutorial focuses on creating a system for displaying damage indicators in 3D and 2D games with grid indicators and tools to easily customize their behavior. This is how it will look like. It is self-contained so that you can just call it from code you already have. The only prerequisite is that you need a way to know how much damage you did, if it was a crit or not, and which target you dealt damage to. It then is as simple as adding this line of code to make this visible to your player. I won't focus on creating movement controllers or FPS melee systems here, as there are already many excellent tutorials on that out there. But if you don't yet have one of those systems yourself, we'll create a simple test scenario so you can understand how everything works and implement it into your projects later. We start with creating the canvas these numbers will be displayed on. I highly recommend creating its own canvas for this to keep everything neat and tidy. If you want or need a refresher on everything canvas related, I have a video for that. Set its canvas scaler to scale with screen size, the reference resolution is 1920 by 1080 or whatever else you like, and its mode is set to expand. We keep the 100 ppu. Delete the raycast component, we don't need to be able to click on our damage labels after all. We need the label next. Create a new TextMesh Pro object inside the canvas. Pick a nice font and a maximum number you know your game will not go beyond. My pick is 9999. Align it to the center and middle and change the size of your box as needed. In case you want to have your crit numbers be bigger, choose that one to design your text field to make sure you're not suddenly getting overflowing numbers. Small aside, if you are using a nice, readable, bold font like this, give your numbers a tiny amount of custom character spacing. It makes bold fonts typically much more readable. Whenever I do a crit, I want that number to stand out and be highlighted with a gradient. But we can't set the vertex color to a gradient. But hey, TextMesh Pro comes with a checkmark for using a dedicated TMP gradient instead. Right-click in the project's folder and choose Create TextMesh Pro Color Gradient. You can choose from a range of options about how you want to orient or angle your gradient with this drop-down and pick colors as you like. Drop this into the dedicated slot on the TMP component. You can instead just change the values inside this without creating the gradient in your project, of course, but by doing it this way, switching up gradients later in the project becomes super simple and quick. If you uncheck the toggle box, it will go back to whichever color you chose for the base version. Just be mindful of this gradient adding its color to the vertex color. Meaning, if your normal damage numbers are blue and your gradient is red, it will look kinda muddy. And by the way, if you like to work even more stylish effects into your crits, I highly recommend the tutorial I did a while back about using custom materials and effects in TextMesh Pro. Our finished system will be using a so-called object pool. That means that we have a storage container, which will be the canvas we created, with a certain amount of copies of this label. Copies will be created when needed, but, and that is the point of a pool, they will be reused as much as possible. This will lessen the load of our game. But for now, keep this in our hierarchy and let's focus on the script for the label. It will have a few jobs. Setting the damage done, handling the visuals for normal hits and crits, fade out the numbers after a certain amount of time, set the arc our labels are supposed to follow, and lastly, animate the movement as well. I also want to have some visual aid that will help us in visualizing how the curve is going to look like even if the game is not running. Red indicates the general movement, yellow additionally shows where and when the text will be fading out. This will be quite a bit of code up front, but I'll be visualizing along the way what's going to happen. If you ever get lost, you can find the scripts for this tutorial on my GitHub page by the link in the description. So let's switch to Rider and start with everything that will handle the design of our label. We will need a reference to our damage text and the normal font size as well as crit font size. These numbers work well enough for me. We also set the normal font color here. And by initializing it with any color right here, we save a few initial clicks whenever we want to reuse the system. If left uninitialized, our color would be black and transparent. I lost count about how often I got confused by nothing showing up, even though I had set a color just because I had forgotten about also setting the alpha value to 1. By initializing it like this, we won't run into this issue. We also want a value for when we want the number to fade out. Easing is about how we want our movement to happen. Should the movement speed up, slow down, or be constant? We can determine this in a way that's neat to experiment with by using an animation curve. Following this, we also need a display duration for how long the label should be on screen. The value itself will be set in the manager later. The movement of our label describes a Bezier curve with a start, which will be determined during play, a high point in relation to the start point, as well as a low point, which will depend on the high one. Sounds confusing, but really isn't once you can play around with it in the inspector. Having the labels flow along the same paths gets visually old really quick, so we can also implement a little bit of random variation by having a height max and height min value we will pick between randomly and add that to the high point. For calculations later, we need two vector 3s for the offsets. We will also implement a way to control the direction of our label's movement. That one will be determined by the manager as well. And lastly, we need a toggle to show or hide the gizmos and a slider for the resolution of the described curve. That's the red line, by the way. 20 is a great pick. Our gizmo will need a starting point to calculate the curve from, and while the transform's position works well enough in the inspector when the game is not running, we want to see the curve from the point of origin when it's in play mode. That's why we are going to need a dedicated starting position for visualization value. Next is a reference to the pool manager we are going to create once this half is done and a coroutine for our movement. Lots of setup, onwards to functionality. Let's start with the visualizations, which happens in the Unity supplied onDrawGizmos method. At first, we need to orient our curve based on the direction the values should fly in. Because we are going to be reusing lots of labels, we need to reset them to their original direction first. In case the direction is different to what we set up initially, we need to switch the x values. We set the initial starting position to the transform's position. In case our application is running, we update it to the starting position for visualization instead. It will be set at a later point when a label is actually being called. We calculate the medium height variation like this to get a good approximation of where our labels will happen to be on the curve. Our curve's high point is then calculated by taking the start value, adding the high point we set in the orient method earlier, and adding the height variation. The drop point will take this high point and add the drop point based on orientation. The color change index handles at which part of the curve the fading will happen, and we can calculate it like this. Due to how gizmos work, our curve is going to be constructed out of multiple straight lines. That's why we need to set a resolution. Our initial point is the starting point. We will then iterate through as many steps as we set in our resolution to create the curve. Each time we calculate the time we are at and the next point by calculating the Bezier point by handing over the time, start position, high and drop point. We will get there in a moment. In case it's equal or higher than our color change index, we will switch to yellow for the line color. And then we can draw a line from the previous point to the next point and set the previous point to the next, repeating this until all lines have been drawn. Calculate Bezier point is something I had to look up. Basically, it calculates the position our labels will be at over the duration of visibility, and it does it well, but I can't explain every line. If somebody finds an error, please write it in the comments. Okay, the roughest parts are over. From here, it's mostly slight variations and reusing of what we have created. We need to initialize our label when it gets created. For that, we take the display duration and a reference to the pool manager we will get to after this and assign them to local values. We then need to orient our curve accordingly. When we need to display a damage indicator, the damage method is going to get called. It sets our label's location as well as the visual starting point to the object we interacted with, position, and stores the reference to the direction. The damage text will be set to the damage value turned into a string. Set the text color to the normal font color or implement a simple check if you crit it, in which case you switch over to being white to not muddy the gradient. We are going to enable the checkbox for the gradient depending on the isCrit value. True if it is, false if it is not. Then this line will change the text's font size depending on the same check. Crit size if it's a crit, normal size otherwise. If there is already a move coroutine running, we need to stop it or run into the chance of having unintended side effects happening. Then we will start and assign a new one. Also, we start a routine which will return the used label back to the pool once the display duration is over. Onwards to movement. We set time to 0 and calculate when the fade should start to happen. We orient the direction of the curve and set the starting position to the transform's position. We set that one earlier to where we need it. We calculate the height variation like this. High and drop point get calculated similar to what we did inside the onDrawGizmo method, but this time we don't need to approximate the location and can use the accurate one instead. Inside the while loop, it will increase the time and calculate the progress along the curve. We look up where we are located on the animation curve, which will handle the way our movement turns out. In case our time value has surpassed the fade starting time, we change the text's alpha value so that it will reach 0 once the display duration is up. Then we set the label's transform position based on the result of the calculate Bezier point method we have created further up. Yield return null will wait for a frame and then repeat the while loop until the duration is up. And lastly for this part, we will need to return our label back to the pool. We can do it like this. If you switch over to the editor, Unity is probably shouting at you about missing things. We are going to handle this now. And hey, if you like my style of tutorial and want to learn more, please click the like button and consider subscribing. The second half of the system is the pop-up spawner. It will be a singleton, so it needs an instance we can call from outside. I am using the Unity object pool for the labels we are going to create. An object pool handles a bunch of objects which should be reused over and over and over and over again, like bullets or arrows or enemies and spawning waves, for example. Damage pop-up labels are fitting well into this category for the same reasons. We will need a prefab of our damage label and set the duration it should be on screen for in this value. I limit my range to something between 0.8 and 1.5 because the lower values feel nice and choppy, great for access on swords, while 1.5 is a good value for slower games or value tweaking for the upcoming animation. We also need a reference to our main camera. In Awake, we handle the typical setup of our singleton, followed by the setup of the Unity pool. It looks like this. First, we create a new pool, which we assign to our damage label pop-up pool. At first, this pool will be empty and it will only fill with stuff when needed. Once that happens, the create func part will be called. First, it instantiates a new damage label and parents it to this object. Then it calls the label's initialize method, handing over infos about how long it should be displayed for and a reference to this pool manager. It then returns it, putting it inside the pool. There are two more functionalities built into Unity's pooling system. ActionOnGet is being called whenever we need to reuse one of the objects inside the pool. In this case, we will just activate it because once we store an object back into it, we disable it. If we wouldn't use a pool like this, we would have to create all this logic ourselves, which is doable, but I really like having a system like this ready to go. Our last stop inside the Awake method is a subscription to the Scene Manager's Scene Loaded event. This gets called whenever a new scene, well, gets loaded, which comes in quite handy when it comes to singletons. We are going to need the main camera and store a reference to it, and if we change scenes, we will lose this reference, setting it to null. That is why once the scene changes, we will grab the current main camera like this. Remember to unsubscribe from this method in onDestroy. Okay, three methods left. Damage done takes the damage amount, the position of the thing we hit, and a bool value for if it was a critical hit or not. Depending on if the hit object is on the left or the right side of the screen, which we check like this, we can hand over the direction the numbers should fly in the spawn damage pop-up method. This all being determined now, we will get an unused damage label from our pool like this and send it all the info it needs to display the correct values. We finish up this class with a method to return a used label back into the pool. The method to do so is release. Finally, back in the editor, attach the spawn damage pop-ups to the canvas element and the damage label to the TextMesh Pro label. Prefab the label and remove it from the hierarchy. Link it up in the corresponding field and the canvas spawn component like this. and prefab your canvas as well. To test it, we need another canvas. Don't create a button straight up, or it will be placed inside your damaged canvas and that one doesn't register clicks anymore. Inside the new one, create a button through right-click UI button and create another script as well. This one is going to be super short and simple. We need some values for crit chance, crit multiplier, min and max damage, and a spawn location. It will be the example location of a thing we interacted with. We have a doDamage method, which calculates all the needed values about how much damage we did and if it is a crit. Then it will hand these values over to the Damage Popup spawner. Let's see it in action. As you can see, depending on where we are to set the X value of our example target, the numbers will fly in different directions, with crits being colored differently. So, in your own project, whenever you determine if you hit something and if so, how hard, you can add this line of code to make it visible to your players. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial and this whole system. Please let me know in the comments. Have a great week!